Respected chairpersons and my dear friends and colleagues, my topic is management of post-traumatic endophthalmitis. I have no financial disclosure. Post-traumatic infectious endophthalmitis is an uncommon but a severe complication of the ocular trauma. It occurs as a result of open globe injury, and seemingly a small injury without obvious intraocular damage may lead to endophthalmitis. It comprises 25 to 30% of all endophthalmitis cases. A retained intraocular foreign body definitely makes the difference of rate of endophthalmitis, incidence of endophthalmitis. If we have retained intraocular foreign body, there is a high chances of having endophthalmitis in those patients. So far as the microbiology is concerned, there is an entirely different scenario in case of traumatic and post-operative endophthalmitis. Here in traumatic, there is a bacillus species is much more common, where in a post-operative endophthalmitis, there is no incidence of bacillus endophthalmitis. High incidence of bacillus serous infection and clostridium are noted in those cases of trauma. There are certain risk factors associated, retained ocular foreign body, as I already told, lens rupture, delay, timing of the primary repair, age greater than 50 years, female gender, large wound size, location of the wound, ocular tissue prolapse, rural patients, virulence of the organism, non-metallic foreign body and larger posterior wound also poses a higher risk for the development of endophthalmitis. Always suspect endophthalmitis in case of severe pain out of proportion of the injury and prolonged discharge, fibrinous reaction, media opacity, lead edema, hypopyon. This is a classical symptom, signs of endophthalmitis. Suspects retained intraocular body in case of endophthalmitis always, and suspects fungal endophthalmitis if inflammation progresses slowly following primary repair. Also suspect clostridia or bacillus serous infection in case of presence of intraocular gas bubble. Diagnosis is classical signs and symptoms, but the culture is the only way to diagnose the infective organism. And the question, which question comes, which intraocular tissue to culture, on what media to culture, and when to interpret growth as a positive or otherwise. Discharge from the conjunctival sacs and lead margin, no. Big no, because there is a poor correlation between the vitreous culture and the discharge from the conjunctival sac and lead margin. So vitreous and aqueous culture is very, very important in those cases. And what to do with the sample? If possible, you know, get the plate yourself and in the OT. One drop of fluid on the blood agar, one drop on the chocolate agar, one drop on the savaroid medium without inhibitors, one drop into thioglycolate broth for anaerobes and microaerophilic microorganism such as P. acne, one drop on each slide of the grams and gymsa stains. So if gram stains are negative, so it doesn't mean that you are not having an infective organism. So it is only positive in 60% of culture positive cases, and all the 64% of cases show positive cultures. In case of non-yielding, go for PCR. For so far as investigation is concerned, ultrasound B scan is necessary to rule out intraocular property and amount of the hemorrhage or other patient develop RD or not after the trauma. X-ray of the orbit is also required. If you are going to repair at the primary intraocular nephrectomy, you are going to repair, the CT scan is always must for those cases, and slices should be not less than 2 mm because to pick up the smallest foreign body into the eye. So far as treatment is concerned, it's divided into two prophylaxis and active management. In case of injury of administration, prophylactic antibiotic is by all routes is necessary because there is a breakdown of blood tissue, blood ocular barrier by the inflammatory process and by the trauma itself. So though therapeutic concentration of drug are as at par with the therapeutic level. Start covering coverage with gram positive and gram negative antibiotics, effective on the gram negative bacteria. Intravitreal antibiotic is not necessary unless it is intraocular foreign body inside the eye. Some recommendation of drug have been used for the traumatic endophthalmitis, like for intravitreal administration. It has been broadly divided into all route, but it is divided into which is foreign body absent or foreign body present. If foreign body is present, then always go for the clindamycin, replaced with the vancomycin. For intravitreal amphotericin, fungal endophthalmitis, intravitreal amphotericin has been used, subconjunctival miconazole, topical natamycin, and systemic administration of ketoconazole, 406 mg orally. Vitrectomy reserved for the non-resolving cases, and it should be done in the primary cases if there is a retinal intraocular foreign body or retinal detachment. It removes the bacteria or fungal load, vitreous sample, you have a ample of vitreous sample after the vitrectomy, clears ocular media, remove toxic products, and better duct diffusion would be there after the vitrectomy. There are some guidelines for the management of suspected traumatic intraocular. Prompt collection of vitreous sample is must. Evaluation for intraocular foreign body is must. systemic perioral topical and antibiotic with all route is important. Vitrectomy is cases of suspected traumatic endophthalmitis. Considered intravitreal corticosteroid is a controversial topic in cases of severe inflammation. Avoid repeat intravitreal injection except in cases with a positive repeat culture or a stain. PCR in the culture negative cases. Thank you.